What happens if we have a low self-worth before we enter a relationship?
We're going to develop patterns that, like, narcissistic type patterns, or people-pleasing.
Abandoning ourselves
for one of those kind of bad behaviors,
really?
that will then can exacerbate a lot of self-hate can come out in self-harm, cutting oneself, diet, controlling what you're eating.
Here's the challenging thing. When we see a friend, a family member, someone we care about that says negative things to themselves, that we see them, their mood cycles are extreme. They could be happy, but then in low places and, like, at home for weeks, and then maybe even doing things to harm themselves. How can a friend, a family member actually communicate so they feel heard, supported, and seen to start improving their life when it seems like it's so hard sometimes to get people to get out of it? Yeah. How can you support and love people that harm themselves so frequently?
Thank you for asking such an important question. Yeah. Such an important question.
Because it seems hopeless sometimes.
It does. It seems hopeless, and it seems like it's going on forever. And it generally will go on for months or years. And it's very, very hard on the family. When you look at it, when you see a loved one, whether it's a family member or a friend, going through these ups and downs where they seem okay and everything, oh, thank God they're okay again. And then there's this massive dip again. So the thing, there's almost like three things that you do there as well. The first thing is make sure that you know how to process what you're going through. Because when you love someone, what happens is you absorb their pain. And I can't absorb, as much as I love my children, I can't absorb their pain. And you try and do it as a parent. You try and absorb their pain. As much as I love my husband, as much as I love my friends, as much as I love you as a friend, and I can't absorb what you've gone through, because I'll try, because I care. So will you. You'll try, and you have, and all of us have. But when you take someone's pain in the way they are, you see them experiencing it, you are actually not going to be able to discern. So you're taking in something that your body doesn't know how to process, because it's not your thing.
Yes.
Then you can't support them. You will start breaking, because it will create tremendous conflict in you, and you'll shift into all kinds of people-pleasing, a denying of the self, and, you know, and it's all kinds of, it becomes chaotic. So it's extremely important to understand that is the issue. And for me to be able to help them, I need my own oxygen mask on. It really is that principle. Your empathy levels and your ability to support your loved one will increase when you look after yourself. It's not selfish. And we have this very kind of almost religious philosophy that I've just got to sacrifice and completely deny myself and serve the other. And a parent, listen, I'm a mother. It feels natural, but it feels like what you should be doing. But you cannot help your child if you're broken and if you're so worn out. So you have to be there, but you have to, and you need to be there 24/7. So how can I be there for my kids 24/7? I have to make sure that I'm strong in myself.
Yes.
And I'm strong with my relationship with Mac. Then otherwise I'm going to crash. And that person that you love, knows that you are the person that they can really get that support from. They see you crashing, that makes them feel shame and guilt.
Mm.
And then a very negative cycle set up. So that's very key, is don't be scared to look after yourself.
Right.
Very important. Then the next thing is to be, and this is the hardest part, to just be there for them.
Really?
It's to be there for them. It's to...
Don't try to tell them what to do. Don't try to give them advice.
No.
Just
be there.
They
can't get out of bed, sit in bed with them.
Wow.
Put the TV on for them. Take them food. Say, hey, do you want me just to... You know, walk to the bathroom and take you to the bathroom. I can sit outside the bathroom door.
So don't shame, don't coach, don't give advice.
Don't ever say things like, God, this has been going on for so long. When are you going to get over this? Also, very important, have a place where you can go out of the home or out of that place, or if they're not living with you, whatever, that someone that you can talk to, a therapist, a good friend, that you can go and explode. You don't mean the words you're going to say.
Right. Just got to get it out. I can't believe they're doing this. What are they doing? Yeah. It's hurting me.
You need a neurocycle on your own, but you need a neurocycle with someone else. You need to go. And it could be a friend. It doesn't have to be a therapist. It can be, you know, you don't have to be a therapist to help each other.
Right.
That's the key. That's what I try and do with my work, is empower people to realize how we have inside of us. And when you go to someone, that's why peer support is so good.
Yes.
Kids are getting great support on social media that are stopping them committing suicide because they're speaking to a peer. And they say, my parents are fighting with them, I can't handle this anymore, I'm going to kill myself. And their peer group is saying to them, no, don't do that. And they supporting them through it. There's the power of just listening and saying, hey, I'm here for you. I'll talk, just tell me your feelings. I don't know how to advise you. I'm the same age as you, but you know what? I'm here for you. That's what you want. It's taking a person's hand, literally, and giving your hand and saying, hey, I don't know what you're going through. I don't understand, but I'm here for you.
Yeah.
And when you're ready to ask me for advice, I can try and give you some, but only when you're ready.
Oh, I'm here for you. So don't give them any advice. Until they ask only for when it. They ask for it.
And they ask for it. What they and as they're pouring out all these things, and let me tell you, as a parent, kids are going to tell you things that they don't mean, but that are coming up from a child's perception of what you did, that you didn't mean to do that, but that's how they perceived it. Don't get hurt. It's going to be very hard. Or if you are hurt, go and talk to the therapist. Go talk to the friend. They're going to say things to you that you didn't know you did that destroyed them and landed them as contributed to where they are today, and you never meant that. You've got to be strong enough in yourself to say, I'm so sorry, even if it requires tears and listening to things, they've got to get it out. And then you thank them. Thank you for saying that to me. Thank you for sharing your heart, and I am so sorry. Thank you for reminding them that. Let's talk about that. Let me, I understood when I did this. This is what it did to you. This is what I tried to mean. And you work through it. You do a neurocycle. You work through that process. And that could mean multiple discussions. And they can go up and down. They might come back and say, things seem to be resolved, and then they come up with another thing. And you as the parent, or you as the best friend, or you as the loved uncle, or whatever you are that's close to that person, or granny, or the caregiver, that's the person that generally very often gets the most attack, because you're the person that's supposed to fix them, and one can fix them. But when we're broken, please fix me, is the cry coming from someone's heart. And we can't fix them. And they can get mad at you for not fixing them. And that's okay. So you've got to be strong enough to handle that.
Man.
Get all these things. Sorry, am I saying too much?
No, it's great. I love it. So, I mean, if someone feels broken in an intimate relationship, are they usually more reactive to the partner if they're not feeling like the partner's helping fix them?
Definitely could be. They can either be more reactive in that they are verbally more reactive and, you know, maybe make demands like that are seem
crazy,
demands,
yeah.
Or they seem possessive or whatever. Or they could withdraw. You know, they could go silent and give you the silent treatment and withhold sort of sexual intimacy and, you know, all kinds of things for kind of to get some level of control.
Right.
You know, there's those aspects. So, yes, so it's, and as a partner, do you feel your partner has some kind of weird behaviors towards you? Well, that's time to talk, and it's time to say, hey, listen, let's go to that safe space. And I noticed this. I know this is not you. Is there something I'm doing or saying? Is there something that you have triggered? Or is there something in your life? Maybe it's not me. Maybe something's happening at work or with your mom or your dad or your best friend, and you just don't feel that I'm here enough to listen to you. Here we are in our talking space or safe space or mind management corner, or neurocycle corner, whatever you want to call it. Let's, you know, let's talk, and I see you doing this. Have I understood you correctly? And, you know, so it's tell a person what you see lovingly, kindly, in the safe space, and say, am I correct? Have I read the situation correctly? Am I, you know, correct me if I'm wrong. I see you doing this, and I know it's not you. You say, so you always validate, always acknowledge, always listen, always compassion, kindness, in love. You talk about wide for love. We have got to immerse in love.
Yes. And what about, where do you believe that the root of insecurity or jealousy comes from in relationships? Is that a wound from the past that makes us insecure or jealous in our current relationship, or where does that come from?
Everything that we do that is impacting us negatively is coming from something we've experienced. Everything. And so we need to live lifestyles of managing our reactions. So we are very capable of standing back and observing ourselves 24/7. Well, you're sleeping when you sleep at night. But then if you do this during the day, your nighttime, when you sleep, our mind and brain are doing housekeeping. And so when we manage our mind well during the day, we get really good advice when we sleep. We get really good cleaning, a good cleaner. So it's essential that we live lifestyles of mind management so that we can observe ourselves. So if I, for example, I've trained myself to do this, if I start noticing a certain pattern in my behaviors, and I notice that there's maybe some jealousy emerging or some envy, I'm very quick to observe it. Now, and I'm not saying I'm a saint at all, far from it. I'm just saying I've trained myself, and I'm proud that I've trained myself, and I'm saying it because you can do this.
Yeah.
And it's not just me. There's millions of people now that we reach, and I hear this all the time, and I saw this in my practice. So I'll observe myself. I watch maybe I snap at Matt because he does something that irritates me, and I've got so used to being around him because we're together 24/7 that I may just, and I'll, you know, find myself getting irritated or being sarcastic. And I'll catch myself and say, I'm sorry, I was sarcastic there. You said something in a way, I didn't really listen to you. You didn't, you know. So you can train yourself to live lifestyle. In other words, if I did have felt that urge of jealousy, I will, let's say, for an interaction with someone else, let's say maybe it's social media and I see something going on, or someone, a friend has, whatever. Jealousy comes wanting what someone else has got. We as humans, and I've got to get this right, we as humans, when I support you and I love you and I lift you up and I am building you and I'm excited, authentically and genuinely excited for every element of your success, without one moment of wishing I had that, I am going to function at my highest intellectual level. I am going to be the healthiest I am. So loving and supporting and lifting you is actually increasing my own intelligence and mind and brain health. However, we are in a zeitgeist of, if what can I get out of you? And if you've got more than me, how did you get it? I need that. They may not be saying that to you, but that's what's going on in their head. That is slowly creating toxic thoughts that are slowly creating a disruption of those microtubule things I spoke about and setting you up for disease and dementias.
Wow.
Big link between, and a sense of loneliness, which is pretty much a guarantee for leading towards dementias and things. So envy, jealousy, bitterness, anger, those things eat you from the inside out. So lifting someone up makes you healthier, being jealous of someone else. So if you are, have a twinge of jealousy, which is first thing, it's okay to be a mess. It's okay. Okay, I feel jealousy. So what? Okay, I feel it. Now what? Why? And then go through the neurocycle, find the source and fix it.
I love this. I feel like we can go on for a long time about this stuff. Is there anything else that you think people should know about how to end toxic thoughts, to get into healthy relationships or relationships in general? Any other?
I think what's so important is that we try and reconnect as communities again and create, you know, there's a big move, and there has been for about 40 years, saying that, yeah, it's great, we're talking about mental health, we're lifting the stigma, but if you look at how we've done it, the research shows we've created a worse stigma.
Really?
And we've actually created environments where people are talking about mental health in a certain way that leads towards seeing it as an illness, in other words, seeing you as a broken person. Now, if I go to a dinner party and I walk in and say, oh, I've just had this another label, I'm now bipolar and this and schizophrenia and blah, 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 everyone at the dinner table is going to kind of be wary, and you're not going to, when you go into a job interview and say that, whatever. But if you go to that dinner and you say, you know, I've just had like such a rough few weeks and I've just seen these patterns in my life, and I, you know, went through this whole sort of exploration and I found out, hey, these patterns are coming from something, and whatever, how much ever you want to share, but now that you tell your story, everyone will lean in and everyone will say, hey, wow, you know, this happened, and everyone will start sharing stories in this community and support and advice and interaction. That's healthy mental health talk, whether it's among an adult, a child, and a baby, an adolescent, 2-year-old, whatever. We need to, that for me is huge, that we need to create genuine safe spaces, not this, oh, I haven't met, it's okay to say it's an illness like diabetes and that makes the stigma go away. And if we can talk about diabetes, no one criticizes you if you've got diabetes. Why do they criticize you if you've got bipolar? Bipolar doesn't even exist. And now, please, I'm not dishonoring the fact that people have mood swings. But if I just say you have bipolar, all I've done is reduce something massive in your life that's absolutely huge, bigger than this room, into just a thing, a little label. I totally invalidated you. But if I say, oh, okay, tell me about this bipolar that you say you've got a diagnosis. What do you mean? And then you describe a set of behaviors. Then I would say, okay, so what you're describing is that you have certain behaviors going on in your life with these emotions, stuff feels in your body. So if that's the case, what's going on? Let's find out why. What's your story? What has happened? Then I've actually tuned in and I've listened to you. That's what I'm talking about.
Right.
That's validating a person. That's recognizing that person who can't get out of bed for 3 weeks or 4 weeks or 2 years, or listening to them, what I spoke about earlier on. That's the validation we need. So I'm, in a nutshell, saying that all these mental health labels reduce something that's massive into something that's not massive and put it into a disease label. That's not good. We've got to come back to our humanity. We've got to see it's huge. If someone's in a panic attack, or someone's depressed, or someone's got these mood swings, or someone's battling to focus or battling to function in a we need to listen to their stories. We need to sit down and connect and communicate and create safe spaces for extreme trauma, which has created extreme behavior changes that they can't really split back in society very well. And they need a couple of weeks or months or whatever to just talk safely in a safe
talk
space.
Talk it out, process it, yeah,
exactly,
get it
exactly.
out.
That for me would be critical. The thing that's making the brain work is your mind. So your mind is your sentience, your aliveness, your ability to have this conversation, to appreciate a rainbow, to love Martha, to do all the different things that we do as a human. That's what our mind is. And it's actually a biofield that's in and around us. It makes us work, it makes your heart pump, it makes you see the meaning of a sunset.